Eddie Glaude Jr., speaking to a brief synopsis about his new book, Begin Again.
James Baldwin and Stokely Carmichael first met during the heady days of the movement to desegregate the South. Carmichael was a young activist and a member of a student group at Howard University called the Nonviolent Action Group, NAG, which sought to combat racism and segregation in Washington, D.C., and in the surrounding areas of Virginia and Maryland. NAG offered a snapshot of the civil rights movement's future. Carmichael's fellow students in the group included Cortland Cox, Michael Thelwell, Muriel Tillinghast, and Ruth Brown, all of whom would go on to be influential leaders in the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC. On Howard's campus, NAG sponsored a series of programs called Project Awareness, which was designed to explore the full complexity and richness of Black life and to engage the controversies surrounding the Black freedom movement. It was through these programs that James Baldwin was invited to campus. During the spring semester of 1963, after the violent response directed at the movement in Birmingham, the group organized a symposium about the role and responsibility of the Black writer in the civil rights struggle. They invited Baldwin, playwright Lorraine Hansberry, novelists John O. Killings and Ralph Ellison, and actor and playwright Ozzie Davis. Ellison sent his regrets, and Hansberry was too ill to attend. But students packed the auditorium. Baldwin had just finished a speaking tour on behalf of the Congress for Racial Equality Corps, and this audience was hungry to hear him speak. Malcolm X, in town by happenstance, dropped in to hear Jimmy hold forth. "Whenever I hear that this little brother is going to speak in any town where I am," he said, "I always make a point of going to listen because I learn something." Baldwin didn't disappoint. He was a captivating speaker with a powerful, almost hypnotic cadence. If the desire to be a preacher had long ago left him, his ability to hold a crowd in his hand had not. It is the responsibility of the Negro writer to excavate the real history of this country, to tell us what really happened to get us where we are now, he boldly declared from the stage at Howard. We must tell the truth till we can no longer bear it. After the symposium ended, Baldwin, Killens, and Davis joined a group of students in the small, cramped apartment of a few NAG members. The hour was late. Jimmy needed a glass of Johnny Walker Black, but the liquor stores were closed. Someone knew a bootlegger. The impromptu rap session went on until sunrise. Our older brothers reasoned with us like family, Carmichael, who would become known as Kwame Ture, later recalled, even though he confused the date of the panel and the subsequent events. "We had 3 years of struggle behind us," he said. "So was the March on Washington and Dr. King's dream. John F. Kennedy had recently been gunned down. The national mood was sore, tense, and uncertain, as was our mood." Everyone understood the burden the students carried on their shoulders. Despite their relative youth, they had already confronted the brutality of the South in an effort to desegregate lunch counters and to register Black people to vote. Many had been beaten and chased down dusty roads in Mississippi and Alabama by the Klan and by white sheriffs. These students were the shock troops of the civil rights movement, and many suffered from the trauma induced by a region and a country reluctant to change. Pessimism and rage threatened to overwhelm them. Baldwin worried about the young men and women like an older brother who did not know exactly how to protect them from the dangers he already glimpsed ahead. For him, the brutality of Bull Connor's dogs and fire hoses in Birmingham had already foreshadowed what was to come, revealing a depth to the country's depravity that no single piece of legislation could cure. As the meeting wound down, Baldwin was left to say the final words, and he brought the conversation full circle to the reason why the students had invited him to campus. "Well, here we are, my young brothers and sisters. Here's how matters stand. I, Jimmy Baldwin, as a black writer, must in some way represent you. Now, you didn't elect me and I didn't ask for it, but here we are. All eyes were fixed on it. Everything I write will in some way reflect on you. So what do we do? I'll make you a pledge. If you will promise your elder brother that you will never, ever accept any of the many derogatory, degrading, and reductive definitions that this society has ready for you, then I, Jimmy Baldwin, promise you I shall never betray you. It was an avowal of love and a declaration of his responsibility as a writer dedicated to speaking the truth.
Up next, an exclusive interview by Jerome Barkum with guest Eddie Glaude, Jr. Eddie is a Princeton University professor of African American Studies and author of his best-selling book, Begin Again. And now, Jerome Barkum.
Hello.
Hello, Eddie.
Yes, this is he.
Hey, Jerome Barkum, how's it going?
Man, I'm doing well. I'm doing well. How you doing?
Man, if it got any better, I'd have to hire somebody to help me enjoy it. So, Eddie,
I heard that.
Eddie, what year did you leave Moss Point?
I left in 1985.
Okay. You too young to know anything about Miss Leela's, huh?
What? Have you lost your... What? Man, that grease that cooked the chicken, the fish. We get that chicken sandwich on some white bread and some potato salad. Man, come on.
Wait a minute. Now, you missed out the best dish, man, because I only went there for one dish, and that was those chitlins.
Oh, I don't eat chitlins.
What's wrong with you, man?
That's what everybody asked me, but, you know, I don't. Growing up, man, I ain't like the smell of the things, man.
Yeah, man.
But my mama would get some chitlins.
Man, when I came home from college, my mother knew the dish that I wanted to eat, so she had it ready for me, man, every time I visited.
That's something else. That is something else. Used to go into Miss Leela's and that old jukebox over in the corner. I play some music. Yeah, man, I remember Miss Leela's. Absolutely.
Well, my dear brother, thank you for joining me on Smooth Jazz Jams Radio TV.
It is my pleasure. I am so delighted. I'm glad we were able to make it happen. I'm sorry about all of the scheduling stuff, but as you can imagine, life has become a bit complicated as of late.
Well, Eddie Glaude Jr., your book, Begin Again, is very powerful, moving, and unmatched.
Well, thank you. You know, it took me, you know, I barely survived writing it, it was a joy. It was a challenge. You know, Baldwin is an exacting companion, and to turn to him in this moment, I'm fond of saying, I've been saying as I've been traveling in the country via Zoom, is that I left the storm of Donald Trump, the chaos of Trumpism, and ran into the storm of Jimmy's life, but it was worthwhile. Absolutely.
Well, Ed, I think we can be safe to say that James Baldwin did not betray us as he told the truth about racism. Now, as an African-American professor at Princeton University, how much have you dedicated telling the truth about racism?
You know, I'm a country boy from Moss Point, Mississippi, and I am a child of Eddie and Juanita Glaude, and there's a sense in which the way I was raised insists that I be true to myself and that I tell the truth about my experiences. I tell a short, quick story. My father, who is this very complicated figure in my life, I remember in the fourth grade, my fourth grade teacher, Miss Davis, was chastising me, and she was doing it in a way that I felt was patently unfair. And I jumped up and called her a racist and ran out of the classroom. And I remember thinking at that time that I was going to get killed, that my daddy was going to take me to the woods. It was going to be a tough time when I got home. And I remember when he walked into from work, because he worked at the post office, and my mother told him what happened. And he said, "What did she say?" And I told her what she said and what she had been doing, and he looked at me in that stern way and said, if anybody ever says anything to you, you do the same exact thing.
I love it.
And so it was instilled in me from a very early age. And so I have dedicated my life to telling the truth as I see it, to bearing witness, to making the suffering real. And Baldwin has helped give me a language to do that over the years, but that's what I have dedicated my life to doing.
Eddie, how do you assess a quote made by James Baldwin that states, hatred, which could destroy so much, never failed to destroy the man who hated?
Yeah, you know, the hatred focus, you know, singles, how can I put this, Doc? Hatred goes imperial. It occupies your focus. It constrains your eyes. You only look at the object to which you're hating. The object that is the object of your hatred. You become singularly focused on it, and then it begins to corrode the soul. So you can't see the expansiveness of the world because you're so focused on what you hate. It becomes the kind of driving force of your way of being in the world. And so hatred distorts the soul. It disfigures the soul. You know, even in 1968, as he was being interviewed in Esquire, a magazine, as cities were burning because of the assassination of Dr. King, they asked Baldwin about the quote-unquote urban rebellions, and Baldwin responded. They said, "What would you tell these young people who are burning up cities and the like?" He said, "I wouldn't tell them not to pick up guns because they have guns. I wouldn't tell them not to do what they're doing. The only thing I would say is that if it comes to the point to where you have to shoot that cat." And he said this, and he said, and it may come to that point. He said, but just don't hate them. There's nothing useful about hatred, right? And so I think it has everything to do with Baldwin's insistence that we don't become the monsters that we're fighting, you know? And he has this formulation that I just absolutely love, and that is he wants us to do something unprecedented. And that is to create ourselves without the need for enemies. I just find that to be beautiful.
It is a beautiful thing. And if I can add my little spin on this, man, if you hate me, I own you. Because, you know, hatred, as you mentioned, it affects your mind and your body, according to studies, all right? Mm-hmm. And it just affects your entire existence. So if you see me and you hate me, I own you.
Exactly. That's it. You possess my eyes, my spirit, and my soul. War is not the answer, for only love
can conquer hate. You know, the only thing that white people have that black people need or should want is power, and no one holds power forever. A quote by James Baldwin. Eddie, do you think white people are losing their power, and if so, how?
Well, I don't know if white people are losing their power. I do know the world is changing. It's morphing. The globe is not what it was. I think in the United States in particular, the demographic shifts are clear that the idea of America becoming a majority-minority nation by 2040 has already made itself known in the culture and in our politics. And so there's this sense in which the nature of the country is changing. And what we're experiencing now, I think, is the kind of nervous, anxiety-ridden, violent response to that sense of change. But that doesn't mean folk have given up the reins of power. It very well may be the case that some people will say will throw the whole thing into the trash bin before they give up the reins of power. And we can't get caught up in kind of the tinkering around the edges, you know, black faces in high places, a few black millionaires, and you know, some who are verging on billionaires as an example of the shift in power, because we know as we look about, Too many of us languish in the shadows, are struggling to make ends meet, are locked up and locked out. So I wouldn't say that white people are losing power by no stretch of the imagination. The world is still dominated by the West. America is still dominated by corporate power and corporate greed that's predominantly white. We got a long fight ahead of us. That's what I believe.
So many voices sit on the scene, giving up all around me, faces full of pain.
We will be back after this important message.
Did you know that African American Garrett Morgan invented the yellow caution light? Traffic signals had already been invented, but they only consisted of two red and green lights, go and stop. The problem was that drivers never knew when the signal was going to switch, as it caused cars to stop abruptly or still be in the intersection when vehicles traveling in other directions began to move. Did You Know is sponsored by Liberty Bank. To learn more, visit libertybank.net.
Jerome Barkum and Eddie Glaude Jr. on his book, Begin Again.
What is the challenge for you to have to decide who you are and force the world to deal with you as you are and not with their idea of what they think you are?
So you were cutting in and out on me. So could you say that again for me, please,
Doc? I said, what is the challenge for you to have to decide who you are and force the world to deal with you as you are and not with their idea of what they think you are?
Yeah, you know, there's this wonderful moment in an interview between Toni Morrison and Charlie Rose. And Morrison, Rose has asked her a question about racism and the like and her novels and the like. And Morrison, in effect, says that she tries to write without that white gaze. Right? She tries to write the novels that she wants to read, inhabit the world that she inhabits, right? So part of the work that we have to do is to understand our lives as canvases upon which we can create art. We have to deal with our own pains, our own wounds, our own traumas. We have to seek a sense of possession of the life that is our own. And that's not contingent upon how others see us. It's not reducible to how others judge us. It's like that moment in 1963 when Baldwin was speaking to those Howard students into the midnight hour. And he asked him to promise him not to believe what the world said about them. And he said if they did that, he would never betray us. And he never did. So part of the work is how do we hold off what the world says about us as we engage in that daunting enterprise of the examined life? It's already difficult to be a human being moving from womb to tomb. And then we have to do that in the context of a world that often despises us, that often is organized along the lines that some people are valued more than the others because they're white or because they're rich. You know, their zip code matters, who they love, who, you know, all of this stuff. And we have to navigate that. But part of what the examined life is all about is trying to understand what moves us in our gut, to try to possess the life that is our own. And that is not contingent upon what people say and what people do. And I've been struggling with that all my life because it's hard. Is hard, but it seems to me there's nothing more powerful to hear than your own voice, mm-hmm. unmediated by what the world expects. When you hear your sound, mm-hmm. right, it's like, you know, Coltrane finding it, Miles hearing it. Duke finding it. Cannonballs hearing it. You know, there's nothing like hearing your own voice. And that's what I'm searching for every single day.
Gotta be me. I gotta be me. What else can I be but what I am? I want to live, not merely survive. And I won't give up this dream of life that keeps me alive. I gotta be me.
James Baldwin often interviewed, leaving the interviewer puzzled. Why do you think, why do you think James Baldwin answered questions with confusedness?
Well, I don't think he was confused. I think he's always reaching for complexity and nuance. He's always trying to shake our assumptions, unsettle our habits. And so there's this sense in which Baldwin, when interviewed, of course, there's a bit of you know, Brer Rabbit in him. He's playing, and he's a bit cantankerous at times and prone to be temperamental. But I think the main thing is he wants to challenge the assumptions often informing the questions that are being posed to him. He wants to try to figure out how we shift the frame. And so when a reporter or an interlocutor is asking him a question that is kind of bound by the frame that he has spent his life trying to undo, oh my goodness, the reaction may be rage. It may be a level of complexity that flummoxes the interviewer. But the whole idea is that, you know, for Baldwin, we can't retreat into the safety of simplistic answers. The hell that we're catching is nuanced and complex, and it requires nuance and complex analyses. So don't step to him with simplicity, right, and easy responses.
The book is very, very deep, very interesting, and I'm going to let you have the last word. I got my book in 2 days, man, from Amazon.
Well, as I said, that it, I put everything in it. I barely survived writing it because Baldwin was asking me to examine the scaffolding of my own lives, what I have built in order to make this world make this life that I happen to live. He asked me to examine it as a precondition to say anything about the world. But listen, I think we're in a moment of reckoning in this country, and we have to be honest with ourselves. In many ways, he confused interviewers because he told the truth, and oftentimes we don't want to hear the truth. And in this moment, we need to bear witness. We need to make the suffering real, because every time a new America is about to be born, the umbilical cord of white supremacy is wrapped around its neck and it chokes the life out of that new baby. So we have to be honest. We have to be courageous. We have to be daring. And we have to begin again. We have to figure out how to imagine this country apart from the ugliness of white supremacy so that we can begin to think of ourselves otherwise, so that we can be together differently. I wrote this book in order to help us do that work, because I don't want to see another generation of black folk and of white folk and Americans broadly having to run on this racial hamster wheel. It's time that we get off this thing and imagine America anew.
Anytime you want to let go and let loose, call me, man.
I appreciate you, man. Lord, I'm trying to keep my head on my shoulder. Once you hit in a certain way, everything changes.
Yeah.
And then you have to kind of figure out how to adjust your life to it and then save space for yourself so that you can find quiet and stillness so that you can keep thinking. Because it's coming at me in these amazing ways, and I'm blessed and I'm thankful. But I got to figure this out. You know what I mean?
Yes, I do understand. Well, thank you, man. Appreciate your time.
I appreciate you, Doc.
I'll be in touch with you, okay?
All right, Doc. Take care now.
See ya.
Right, bye-bye.
Do you want a copy of this interview? Please visit smoothjazzgems.com.
Whether I'm right or whether I'm wrong, whether I find a place in this world or never belong, I gotta be me. I gotta be me. What else can I be but what I am? I want to live, not merely survive. And I won't give up this dream of life that keeps me alive. I gotta be me. I gotta be me. The dream that I see makes me what I am. That faraway prize, a world of success, is waiting for me if I heed the call. I won't settle down, won't settle for less. As long as there's a chance that I can have it all, I'll go it alone. That's how it must be. I can't be right for somebody else if I'm not right for me. I gotta be free. I've gotta be free. Daring to try to do it or die. I've gotta be me. I'll go it alone. That's how it must be. I can't be right for somebody else if I'm not right for me.